Hallelujah. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
We'll join in hymn number 619, I Know That My Redeemer Lives, the first four verses and then the last verse.
Sunday worship, and today we are blessed to have joining us by video our presiding bishop, Deborah Hutterer. She's going to begin with some words that she is sharing with all the congregations across the synod, and then she'll bring us the scripture and then the sermon. I want to prepare you for something a little bit later on in the service. During the sermon, we have the scripture where Jesus shares the peace with his disciples, and we know that there are many people that you want to share the peace with. So during the service, we'll take a little time for you to share the peace with people that you love that may be scattered around the world, and do like you would normally do at home, even though they're not there. So we might say, the peace of the Lord be with you always, Kintaro. The peace of the Lord be with you always, Marie. And you've got that minute to pray for peace for the people that you love around the world. Let's listen to our bishop.
It is good to be here with you. I bring greetings on behalf of Presiding Bishop Elizabeth Eaton, as well as the Grand Canyon Synod staff. You have been in our thoughts and our prayers during these unusual times. Some of you know that one of the goals of the Office of the Bishop is that our rostered leaders would visit every congregation within the first year and a half of when I became bishop, which was September of 2018. And by the grace of God, we achieved that goal. My personal goal was that I would get to visit every congregation by the time I'd been installed for 2 years. It was apparent at the end of last year that logistically it was impossible to be able to reach that goal. However, through the use of technology, I am able to be with you in worship Well, maybe that doesn't really count. Seriously, I yearn for the day in which we can worship face to face. And then finally, just a thank you to all of you, your pastors and leaders and readers, people who have been adjusting to what it is to worship using iPads and iPhones and computers in ways that you could never have imagined. I am grateful for the ways in which we have all been able to adapt and learn and grow, all the while remembering that we are God's people and continuing to proclaim the message of the risen Christ. The Gospel of the Lord is taken from the 20th chapter of John. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, was one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Each year on the eve of my children's birthday, I call and recount in detail their birth stories. I remember when they were younger how much they looked forward to that. And when they became teenagers, they would roll their eyes. And now as they've become older, I think they've appreciated the story even a little bit more. I find that they'll remind me of the details that I have forgotten or that I have glossed over. We're story people. We like to hear and tell stories. When you tell your story, it connects with experiences and people in my life. We tell stories to create meaning in the good times and the not so good times. We tell stories so that we can laugh at ourselves. We tell stories so that we might have courage and be brave. We tell stories so that we might have hope. That's what the Bible is full of, stories of God and God's people. It is the story of who we are and to whom we belong. And these are stories that sustain faith. I don't know if there's a more perfect time than for this gospel story. It is the evening of the day of resurrection, and the disciples were in a room with the doors locked for fear of the Jews. And Jesus comes and stands among them and says, "Peace be with you." And then he showed them his hands and his side. We can only imagine what they might be feeling as they saw those visible wounds. But again, Jesus says, "Peace be with you," and breathes on them the gift of the Holy Spirit. Thomas wasn't there, and without seeing for himself, he said he couldn't believe. And when Jesus comes back a week later and offers Thomas the opportunity to touch those wounds, he sees Jesus and all he can say is, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus responds by saying, "Blessed are those who believe and have not yet seen." We understand fear all too well. There has always been something in our life that we can be fearful of. This year, we have some kind of communal fear. We are behind locked doors for the fear of spreading or catching COVID. We fear as we watch the numbers of deaths, as we wonder about available hospital beds and medical equipment and personal protection. We fear for our jobs and the economy. And fear, as it always does, keeps us paralyzed and locked up behind closed doors and inside ourselves. And we, like those first disciples, can wonder, is Jesus really present? There's one thing that seems to be consistent about these post-resurrection stories. There's some kind of honest doubt, some hesitancy to believe, even when hearing the testimony of trusted friends, or even when Jesus is standing right in front of them. That actually should be a comfort for us. And maybe it can be the time when we can confess our doubts and our struggles, our places where it's hard to believe. The third article of both the Apostles and the Nicene Creed speak to this gift of faith. In fact, two of the Holy Spirit's works are to bring faith and to keep us in faith. It is the gift of faith from the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Advocate that Jesus sent. The Holy Spirit that allows us to believe these stories are for us and strengthen us for the work of discipleship. The gift of the Holy Spirit gives us a boldness to testify to the places where we have seen and experienced the risen Christ in our own lives. And into their fear, Jesus breathes on the disciples this gift of the Holy Spirit and the gift of peace. Those familiar words that we exchange in worship, "The peace of the Lord be with you." It's not just the absence of war or some place of silence. It's the peace of Jesus that offers the fullness of life and well-being. Peace that leans into our anxiety and our fears so that they no longer have a hold over us. And this is not just a gift for us. It is a gift for all of God's people. The gospel lesson today concludes with why John captured and recorded these stories, when he says, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are recorded so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you might have life in his name." The gift to believe brings life. The two are inextricably linked. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King once wrote, "Science investigates and religion interprets. Science gives knowledge, which is power. Religion gives wisdom, which is control. Science deals with facts and religion deals with values. The two are not rivals." In this time of COVID-19, we are grateful for the people in science and in medicine, as well as those who do all of the work to support them. They give us physical well-being. Those men and women have offered us directives and guidance so that all may have physical life. And yet, we know that not all people have this fullness of life. We know that it's the poor and the vulnerable among us, the homeless, those in nursing homes, those with disabilities, the undocumented workers, the refugees who will be most affected. In fact, even the simple act of hand washing for 20 seconds with clean water and soap is a gift. Many of our brothers and sisters do not have access to some of the most basic needs, but God meant them for all people. As people who are claimed by Jesus, believing and having life guides the way that we live, our values, values that call us to care for our neighbor. I was forwarded an email from one of my ecumenical colleagues that said, if you get an email that begins with knock, knock in the subject line, don't answer it. It's a Jehovah's Witness who's working from home. Now, for Lutheran Christians who happen to be shy about sharing their faith, our brothers and sisters can model something for us to follow. We are called to witness to God's love for the world through our actions as well as through our words, so that we all have life. You witness to new life as you try to understand new technologies with computers and tablets and iPads that connect you to your church and your neighborhood and to your families. You witness to new life as you take on the role of being a teacher for children who are now at home. You witness to new life as you make and wear face masks, as you deliver food or check in on those who are near and far away. You witness to new life as you share your financial resources so that we might do ministry in our neighborhoods and in the wider world. Your gifts to your congregation are also shared with the Grand Canyon Synod so that we might support local ministries like Lutheran Social Services of Nevada and Lutheran Social Services of the Southwest, as well as with the wider church where we support Lutheran Disaster Response, Lutheran World Relief, and World Hunger. We support those who we see right next to us as well as those who can be invisible, because we know that God wants abundant life for them as well. God uses the gifts that you've been given, lets you share them so that you can be a blessing. And friends, we bring new life by telling our resurrection stories, the stories where God has brought new life to you. In these days of being surrounded by the very grim and real stories of COVID-19, we're also among the just regular day-to-day places in life where friends and family battle cancer or depression or addiction. We still live with those just day-to-day places of brokenness and loss. And we need resurrection stories to remind us that fear and anxiety and death do not win. We are Easter people. The risen Christ comes to us today and breathes on us the gifts of forgiveness and hope and new life through our doing and our telling. And the breath of Jesus is the same peace that he gave the first disciples, the peace of God that passes all understanding, to guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed.
We'll join in hymn number 635, We Walk by Faith.
Where you
Now at this time, I invite you to share the peace through prayer and lifting up the names of those that you want to have God's peace upon. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Rejoicing in the wonder of new life in Jesus Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of God's creation. Faithful God, you perform wonders in our world. Open our eyes to your marvelous power, and when we do not see or believe, gift us with faith. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear us, Jesus.
Present One, you dwell among your gathered people. Grace the church with your Holy Spirit that through hearing your word and sharing your peace, we may embody resurrection hope in the world you created. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear us, Jesus. Hear us, Jesus. Hear us, Jesus.
Mighty God, in Jesus Christ, you offer peace beyond human understanding. Impart wisdom to the nations, that peoples imprisoned by fear and greed would see and believe in freedom and peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear us, Jesus. Hear us, Jesus. Hear us, Jesus.
Healing God, you wore our flesh and pain in Jesus. May your healing touch comfort the sick and the lonely and all who cry out to you. Watch over Don Noller, Cindy Nicholas, Diane Johnson, Marita Fink, Leslie Spees, Sandra Smith, Lori and Donna, Marjorie Hanlon, Stella Ardolino, Mary, Elizabeth, and Sherry Dunn. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear us, Jesus. Hear us, Jesus. Hear us, Jesus. Risen Lord.
With our Lord's people of every time and place, let us sing our Lord's Prayer.
Give us
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, watch over you and keep you safe.